Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Salatu Wassalamu ala Ashraf al-Mursaleen, Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. We had to start late because we changed the time and many people don't pay attention to the new timing. They are used to come here at 8 o'clock. But anyway, today inshaAllah we'll be talking about al-Ayman and al-Nudhur, yani oaths and vows and their expiation in the Islamic Sharia. And these are two different chapters, and sometimes they are together in one chapter. It depends on the, you know, every faqih, every alim has his own methodology. But basically, al-ayman is the plural word of al-yameen. And al-yameen means in Arabic the right hand. And this oath was named al-yameen because it was the habit of the Arabs, whenever they make an oath or they promise each other something, they would shake hands. So it was called al-yameen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called it al-yameen or al-ayman in the Quran. لَا يُؤَاخِذُكُمُ اللَّهُ بِاللَّغْوِ فِي أَيْمَانِكُمْ. So these are oaths. And in Islamic fiqh, it means to confirm something by mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or one of his attributes. You confirm your plan, you confirm something that you want to do in the future, or you confirm an information. You are telling someone about something that happened or took place, telling him about an event, and you want him to believe you, then you mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you include the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or one of his attributes in your statement, and that would be an oath. So you would be swearing by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But basically, we know, alhamdulillah, this is basic knowledge, many people know about it, that swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not permissible. Yani we are not allowed to swear by anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or one of his names, and this is a sin in Sharia. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the famous hadith, أَنَا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْهَاكُمْ أَنْ تَحْلِفُوا بِآبَائِكُمْ فَمَنْ كَانَ حَالِفًا فَلْيَحْلِفْ بِاللَّهِ أَوْ لِيَصْمُتْ. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a famous hadith, verily Allah forbids you to swear by your fathers. That was maybe the habits of them, some of the Arabs at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They used to mention the names of their fathers when they want to make an oath. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them at that time, you are not supposed to do it. If one of you has to take an oath, then he should swear by Allah, otherwise he should keep quiet. It's better for him to keep quiet. In a different hadith, he said, مَنْ حَلَفَ بِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ فَقَدْ أَشْرَكْ. So he said, whoever swears by Allah, then he has committed shirk. Now, here we have to be careful. يعني, this is a good example about the fact that small knowledge or a little bit of knowledge could be very dangerous. If someone who would read this hadith and think right away that the person who does something like that becomes a mushrik, yani he becomes a non-Muslim. The ulama, they said, this is shirk asghar, this is minor shirk. And minor shirk or minor kufr does not take the person out of the fold of Islam. He does not become a real mushrik. He does not become a kafir, a disbeliever in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So minor kufr or minor shirk is a sin. It is a major sin. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to, I think he used this term, a shirk, to encourage people to stay away from it, not to swear by anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this, the expiation of this oath, the ulama, they said, is to make istighfar, to make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't have to pay anything. You just have to say la ilaha illallah, because there is another hadith in which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man halafa faqala fi halfihi billati wal uzza falyaqul la ilaha illallah. He didn't say that he becomes a kafir, because if he becomes a kafir, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say that he should say la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. But here he's saying he should say la ilaha illallah. Whoever amongst you swears by Lat and al-Uzza when making an oath. And Lat al-Uzza, they were two idols that used to be worshipped at the time of Jahiliyyah, before, during the pre-Islamic era. One of them was in the area of Mecca and the other one was outside the city of Mecca. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever swears in his oath and makes a mistake in his oath by saying by Allat and Al-Uzza, then he should say La ilaha illallah, and that would be the kafara of this mistake. He is not supposed to pay anything, and this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. So the rule here is swearing by one's father, one's mother, by the life of the Prophet ﷺ. This is, by the way, a common mistake. Wahiyat al-Nabi. They say, people will say Wahiyat al-Nabi, Wahiyat Ummi, Wahiyat Abuya. These are common mistakes in our community, in different communities. I don't know in the other non-speaking Arabic communities. I'm not sure, but I'm talking about my community. This is very common. This is a common mistake. People swear by the life of their mothers, by the life of their fathers, by the life of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, or the name of Jesus, or any other creation, anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not permissible, and it is a sin. And this is a common mistake, that when you hear someone, you know, saying something like that, you should correct them. Bi adab, you have to be kind. You should correct them and tell them this is not permissible in the Sharia of Islam. Basically, there are three types of oaths. In general, there are three types of oaths. The first one is al-yamin al-ghamus. It could be translated as the engulfing oath. And this is very dangerous. لأنه العلماء قالوا سميت غموسا لأنها تغمس صاحبها في الإثم أو تغمس صاحبها في النار. He said, the ulama, they said it was called the engulfing oath because it's either immerses the one who says it in sin, he becomes sinful, or it immerses him in hellfire, nas'Allah salama wal afiyah. So it is to swear by Allah that the person did or did not do something in the past while deliberately lying about it. So he is lying about it on purpose. He knows that he's lying. He knows that he's lying. And it has two levels. The normal engulfing oath, when you give a false information to other people. It is yamin kadhiba, it is ghamus, but this is there is another yameen that goes to a higher level, where you use this yameen, this oath, to take the property of someone else. So there are two types. In the first yameen, you don't take the property of anyone. You don't take their money. You don't hurt them. But you give them wrong information. You tell them, wallahi, I traveled yesterday to Mathan, this town. And you know that you didn't make this trip. So this is yameen kadhiba. But it's not like the one that you make when having a dispute with someone else, a financial dispute, مثلاً. Someone gave you a loan, and you stand up in front of the qadi and the judge, and you say, wallahi, I didn't take anything from him. So this is yameen ghamus, and Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, صاحبها متوعد بالنار وبالعذاب يوم القيامة. So the person who makes this oath to take the property of another Muslim will face severe consequences on the Day of Judgment. And he is a promise of a severe punishment on the Day of Judgment. Unless he makes tawbah and returns the property to its owner, rightful owner, and makes tawbah, that's a different story. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. But it is a major sin. The ulama, they said, al-yamin al-ghamus is a major sin. We should not use the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while lying, while saying a false information, giving false information to other people. The second type of yameen is called the yameen al-mun'aqidah, the enacted oath. And it is to willfully swear by the name of Allah to do or not to do something in the future. And you're talking about a plan here. Inshallah, wallahi, I will do this and this and this. I will give you $500, or I will do this, or I will read just from the Quran, or I will fast Mondays and Thursdays next week. Any plan. So something to do in the future or not to do. I will, by Allah, I will never do this. Okay? This is something, you're not giving any information about something that took place in the past. You're talking about future plans. Or, So the ulama, they said here, if a person breaks this oath, then he has to make the expiation, and we'll talk about different types of expiation at the end. And you had a plan, and you used the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your oath, but you didn't fulfill that plan, then you have to make an expiation. And sometimes it is not a sin to break your oath. We'll talk about it. Because this is another common mistake many people think. When you make an oath, you have to fulfill it. No, sometimes maybe you have to break your oath, or you need to break your oath for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do something better. So it's not always a sin to break your oath. This is a common mistake that we'll talk about it today, inshallah. But this is called al-yameen al-mun'aqida, the enacted oath. When you have the intention to make an oath, you're talking about a plan, and you have the intention to make an oath, to confirm this plan. The third type of oaths is yameen al-laghu, the mistaken oath. And the mistaken oath is to swear, the first type of this mistaken oath, to swear about something thinking that it is as such, while in reality it was not as you thought. So you tell someone, wallahi, it was raining today in Algeria, for example. Based on your knowledge about the forecast, you read about the forecast last night, and you thought that it will be raining today in Earthly. So you made an oath, used the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هذه يمين له. What does it mean? It's a mistaken oath. You don't have to pay any expiation. If you know that it did not rain in Earthly today, there is nothing wrong with it, and you didn't mean to lie. But you thought that it rained in Earthly today. So you gave him some information based on your previous knowledge. But it turned out to be different. Yeah, and you found out that it was not, the case was not as you thought. So here there is no blame on you, and there is no expiation that is due for this mistaken oath. The second type of yameen al-laghu, the mistaken oath, is to swear by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with no intention of making any oath. It is part of your daily speech. There are people who have the habit to use the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with every statement. Wallahi, you go first. Wallahi, you come here, sit down here. Wallahi, you eat this. I mean, this is a habit. It's not good, but this is yameen al-laghu. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not punish you for this yameen because you don't have the intention. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not impose any blame on you because you don't have the intention to make any oath. But you just have the habit of using the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not something that is appreciated in Sharia, but it's not a sin. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَا يُؤَاخِذُكُمُ اللَّهُ بِاللَّغْوِ فِي أَيْمَانِكُمْ. This is in Surah Al-Baqarah. وَلَكِنْ يُؤَاخِذُكُمْ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ. So in Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 225, he said, Allah does not impose blame upon you for what is unintentional in your oaths. But he imposes blame upon you for what your hearts have earned. What does it mean? When you have a plan and you have the intention to make an oath, here now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you break this oath, then there are some consequences that you have to pay. You have to deal with some consequences. But if you use yameen al-laghu, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and forbearing. Because at the end of the ayah, he said, Wallahu ghafurun haleem. Allah is forgiving and forbearing. Wallahu ta'ala alam. There is another safety clause that you can use in your oaths to be in the safe side. To say insha'Allah, if you are not sure about yourself, if you are not sure about your future plans. So the ulama, they said, when the oath contains the safety clause of saying insha'Allah, then the person will not be guilty of breaking his oath. That means he doesn't have to pay anything, and he is in the safe side. What is the proof? Is the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ, "من حلف على يمين فقال إن شاء الله لم يحنث." This is a hadith from Rasulullah ﷺ, Rawah Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i. He said, "Whoever swore an oath and said إن شاء الله, then if Allah's wills, if Allah wills, he would not be guilty of breaking his oath. If he breaks it." So he doesn't have to pay anything, he doesn't have to deal with any expiation. So if you add insha'Allah, the ulama, they said this clause has to be connected with the first statement. You don't say insha'Allah after 1 hour or 2 hours. Okay? This is the opinion of the majority of scholars, wallahu ta'ala. Both statements have to come from the same person. Yani you don't say something, and then your friend or your companion will say insha'Allah, then you keep quiet, you don't say anything. This is not an exception for you to your statement. Your statement is not, you are not in the safe side, which means if you break your oath, you still have to deal with the consequences, because it is your friend who said insha'Allah, not you. And they said it has to be clearly pronounced. The intention of making this exception is not enough, it's not sufficient, it's not accepted. You have to clearly pronounce this exception or this safety clause of saying insha'Allah. طيب. What if a person swears an oath to do something and then he thinks that there is another action that is better, another course of action that is better? Yani he makes an oath not to give any sadaqah to so-and-so. And then he would think about it again and say, I mean, it doesn't make sense. Giving sadaqah is always good. Maybe I should give him sadaqah, this person. Although they didn't have a good relationship, so he made this statement, and then he changed his mind. So here he is allowed to break his oath and give that person sadaqah, but he has to pay the kafara. He has to make the expiation. As I said, we'll talk about it. What is the proof? Is the hadith of Rasulullah. He was talking to Abdurrahman ibn Samura radiallahu anhu, and he told him, وَإِذَا حَلَفْتَ عَلَى يَمِينٍ فَرَأَيْتَ غَيْرَهَا خَيْرًا مِنْهَا فَكَفِّرْ عَنْ يَمِينِكَ وَأْتِ الَّذِي هُوَ خَيْرٌ. Hadith al-Bukhari wa Muslim. So he was talking to Abdurrahman ibn Samura alayhi salatu wasalam, talking to Abdurrahman ibn Samura radiallahu anhu, and he told him, whenever you take an oath to do something and later you find that something else is better, it's a better choice, he said, then kafir an yaminik, expiate for your oath and do what is better for you. And this is one of the common mistakes in our community, that people think when they make an oath, that's it, they are not supposed to change it unless they are forced to, or they don't have a choice, or no, it's okay. If you find a better choice, then pay the kafara, make the expiation, and do what is better for you or your family or your community. Now, what is the expiation of a valid oath? We said if yameen is ghamus, someone is lying and it's engulfing oath, he doesn't have to pay anything. It is a major sin, but he doesn't have to pay because it is not an accepted oath. If someone has made a mistaken oath, yani he made an oath about something thinking that it is as such, and then he found out that the story is different, it's a different case, but he didn't mean to lie, he made a mistake, then he doesn't have to pay anything. There is no kafara for this oath. Or it is his habit to use the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time, he doesn't intend to make any oath, then here he doesn't have to pay. Now we're talking about a valid oath, which we call the yameen al-mun'aqida in Arabic, or the enacted oath. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about the kafara in Surah Al-Ma'idah, in ayah 89. He said, لَا يُؤَخِذُكُمُ اللَّهُ بِاللَّغْوِ فِي أَيْمَانِكُمْ. This is in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah will not impose blame upon you for what is meaningless in your oaths. يعني it doesn't have any meaning. وَلَكِنْ يُؤَخِذُكُمْ بِمَا عَقَّدْتُمُ الْأَيْمَانِ. But he will impose blame upon you for breaking what you intended of oaths. This is in the same ayah 89 in Surah Al-Ma'idah. And then he said, فَكَفَّارَتُهُ إِطْعَامُ عَشَرَةِ مَسَاكِينَ مِنْ أَوْسَطِ مَا تُطْعِمُونَ أَهْلِيكُمْ. There is another common mistake here. People, whenever they break an oath, they think about fasting 3 days. This is a big mistake, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give us the choice of fasting till the end. And we'll, this is very clear in this ayah. If you check this ayah in Surah Al-Ma'idah 89, you don't go to fasting right away. No, you have to follow the steps that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. So here he said, فَكَفَّارَتُهُ إِطْعَامُ عَشَرَةِ مَسَاكِينَ مِنْ أَوْسَطِ مَا تُطْعِمُونَ أَهْلِكُمْ أَوْ كِسْوَتُهُمْ أَوْ تَحْرِيرُ رَقَبَةٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning here the first option, but within this first option is giving us three choices. Within the first step or first level is giving us three choices. The first choice is to feed 10 needy people from the average of that which we feed our families. Yani it doesn't have to be expensive, it doesn't have to be very cheap. If you spend مثلا, the average of $10 for your lunch or for your dinner, that would be the value of your kafara. And you need to feed 10 people. 10 different people is not enough to feed one person 10 times. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Asharat masakeen. He said, you need to feed 10 people, 10 needy people. And this is the first choice. The second choice is to clothe them. And we'll talk about the criteria or the measurement of this clothing. And the third step is to free a slave. But we don't have slaves these days, so it's not an option for us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ فَصِيَامُ ثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامٍ. But whoever cannot find or afford it, then a fast of 3 days is required, and that is the expiation of oaths when you have sworn. ذَلِكَ كَفَّارَةُ أَيْمَانِكُمْ إِذَا حَلَفْتُمْ. طيب, so we have the food, as I said, and it's enough to, what is the value of this food? The minimum value, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, is 1.5 kg of rice or wheat. This is the minimum. 1.5 kg is like the kafara of breaking a fast in Ramadan. If someone was sick or is suffering from permanent sickness and he's not able to fast, then he has to pay for each day this value, this amount of food. All the ulama, they said it's better to make it a full meal, either lunch or dinner. So the minimum value would be 1.5 kg, kilogram, of rice or wheat, and then it's always better to make it a full meal with some meat, some juice, you know, $10-$15, Allah Ta'ala alam, but we'll talk about the money now, about paying money, paying it in cash. Now the second step or the second choice, which is clothing, they said the ulama, you give them enough clothes for their prayer to be valid. Yani one hat is not enough. If you give him one pant is not enough. So the clothing that you give him has to be enough for him, for his prayer to be valid. For a woman, you need to give her a hijab, full hijab, with a khimar. Because she cannot pray without covering her head. She has to cover her head. If you are giving some clothing to a woman. A man, he doesn't have to cover his head, but at least you give him enough clothing for his prayer to be valid. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Are we allowed to give them money? Majority of scholars, they said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned food and clothing. He did not mention money, so you shouldn't give money. In the Hanafi school of thought, they said it is permissible to pay them money, to give them money. And the conclusion, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, as it was made by some scholars, they said you try your best to offer this kafara in the form of food or clothing. If you are not able to do that, like here, it's very difficult to find sometimes 10 people who need some rice or wheat. It could be difficult here. It could be easy back home in many countries, but here it could be difficult. So you can give them money, or you send it to a relief organization and you tell them this is kafarat yameen, and then they have to take care of it. They have to buy food and give it to those who are in need in different countries. So the ulama, they said, this is the conclusion, this is the best opinion. They say you try your best to pay it in the form of food or clothing, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned it in Surah Al-Ma'idah. If you are not able to do that, then it is enough. It should be fine to pay it cash. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Now, about the fasting. There are two opinions about fasting these 3 days. Are we supposed to fast them in a row, consecutively, or we can spread them out? So the best opinion, wallahu ta'ala alam, is to fast them in a row. Unless someone had an excuse, yani he had to travel or he became sick after the first day, this is a valid excuse, he can continue the next day. Like he had to break the fast the next second day, he can continue after that if he has a valid excuse. If he didn't have a valid excuse, is better for him to repeat the fast and fast them consecutively in a row, and that without any interruption, and that would be inshallah accepted from him. How do we know when is the person is unable to feed or buy clothing? When the person is when does he have the right to say, I'm not able to feed, I'm not to buy any clothing, I'll just move to the other option, which is fasting 3 days. So the majority of scholars, Jumhur al-Ulama, they believe that if a person has more than what he needs for himself and his family within 24 hours, and what is left after that is enough to feed 10 people, then he has to feed these 10 people. That could be very difficult for some people who are poor, not for most of people can afford actually to pay the kafara for 10 people. But in case there is a person who has enough for 24 hours to feed himself and feed his family, and the rest is enough to pay the kafara for 10 people, they said, the jumhur ulama, majority of scholars, they said he has to pay this money, which could be very difficult in this case if someone has only something left for a few days and then he has to pay it as a kafara. The opinion of Imam Shafi'i is a little bit different, is more merciful. Imam Shafi'i said if the person is deserving of zakat, like he's faqir or miskeen, is deserving of zakat, then he doesn't have to pay anything. He has the right to move to the next step, which is fasting 3 days. Like مثلاً, someone, what is the criteria, or what is the, how do we know that the person is faqir? The ulama, they said, if his income is less of 50% of what he needs for the whole year, he needs 20,000 to cover the basic expenses for the whole year, and his income is less than 10,000. He needs 20, his income is less than 10,000. This is a faqir and he deserves to receive zakat. A miskeen, someone who is better than this faqir, his income is more than 50%, 60%, 70%, but he still is not enough. He needs 20,000, his income is 15,000. He's still is short of that 5,000. So he's miskeen, he's not faqir. But the second one deserves zakat too. So the Imam Shafi'i, he said if a person deserves to receive zakat from other people, then he's faqir or he's miskeen and he doesn't have to pay the kafara, offer the kafara in the form of food or clothing, and he has the right to move to the other step, to the next step, which is fasting 3 days. This is more merciful. Wallahu ta'ala alam. Now let's talk a little bit about nuzur, vows. And then if you have questions, we'll leave them till the end, inshallah. A nadhr is different than an oath. A nadhr, and most of the people when they talk about a nadhr, they said nazr. They use the Z instead of TH or DH. In Arabic is nadhr, because the Quran used the word nadhr or nuzur. So with that, but when it is translated in books, in English books, usually people use the letter Z. I don't like it because people will not pronounce it in the right way. People will keep saying nazr, nazr, nuzur, but in Arabic is nazr or nuzur. Okay, so a nazr here, which is vow in English, is to make something which is not obligatory an obligation upon yourself. Due to some occurrence, yani you are facing some conditions, some hardship, or without any hardship, you just thought about making a nadhr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making a vow to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make i'tikaf in the masjid for one night, to fast one day, to give a sadaqah, to slaughter a dhabiha for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or do something. So it's a little bit different than an oath. Oath, you can make an oath and say, wallahi, I will do this and give this sadaqah. But in another, you don't use the name of Allah, but you say, I vow to, lillahi alayya, I promise Allah. Even the word promise is not clear, is not used directly in nuzur. When you make another, the translation, the English word is vow. In Arabic, lillahi alayya nadhrun an a'mala kada. You know, it is, I am making it an obligation upon myself to do this and that. ولذلك في اللغة العربية قالوا إلزام مكلف مختار نفسه عبادة لله غير لازمة له بأصل الشرع. It was not an obligation upon him, but he himself decided to make it obligatory upon himself. It's his choice. And that's why the ulama, they said, it's not good. It's not a good idea to make a nadhr. If you want to make i'tikaf without making any nadhr. If you want to fast, fast without making any nadhr, without making any vow. If you want to give sadaqah without making any vow. Because if you make a vow and you are not able to fulfill it, or you don't fulfill it, this is not something that is appreciated in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about ibadullah salihin, the pious people who will receive the reward of Jannah on the Day of Judgment. One of their sifat, yufuna bin nadhri wa yakhafuna yawman kana sharruhu mustatira. So in Surah Al-Insan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about those who will deserve Jannah on the Day of Judgment. And he said, there are those who fulfill their vows. So if you make a vow, you are not able, or you don't fulfill it, that is not something that is appreciated in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It could be a sin. And they fear a day whose evil will be widespreading. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a famous hadith, he talked about the qualities of the first three generations. They said they are the best of this ummah, the first generation, the people who lived with him, and those who come after them, and those who come after them. And then he mentioned the other rest of people, and he mentioned some bad qualities. One of them, he said, يُنذِرُونَ وَلَا يُوفُونَ بِالنَّذْرِ. They would make vow, but they would not fulfill them. One of the qualities of the people who will come after the three first generations. So it's not something to make a vow, it's not something good to make a vow and not fulfill it. And that's why Rasulullah SAW said, مَنْ نَذَرَ أَنْ يُطِيعَ اللَّهَ فَلْيُطِحُ وَمَنْ نَذَرَ أَنْ يَعْصِيَهُ فَلَا يَعْصِهِ. This is in Bukhari. He said, whoever vows that he will obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or perform an act of ibadah, then he should remain obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He should fulfill his vow. And whoever made a vow that he will disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he should not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He should not fulfill his vow. Now, talking about conditional vows. What are conditional vows? These are very common. Very common. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised the ummah, encouraged the ummah not to do them. These conditional vows. And they happen when a person says, if Allah cures my son, then I will fast, مثلاً, 2 months. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cures my mother, I will pay $100, مثلاً, as sadaqah. $100 is not a big deal. But there are people who make crazy vows. Crazy vows. I know someone who said, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfill my wish and give me this and that, I will keep paying. I'll pay the half of my income or my salary for the rest of my life. That's a crazy vow. And then, mashallah, he became professional and his salary was, his income was big. And then he found it very difficult to fulfill the vow. Even his accountant found it difficult to calculate his donations and he felt like he's not paying, he's forced. Like he forced himself to pay this sadaqah. You shouldn't force yourself. And this is what Rasulullah said, إن النذر لا يقدم شيئا يعني لا يغير من قدر الله سبحانه وتعالى. If Allah سبحانه وتعالى is planning to give you what you want, He will give it to you, whether you make this statement, this vow, or you don't make it. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not write this ni'mah or this bounty or this risk for you, you will not get it. So there is no point of making this vow. So that's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ النَّذْرَ لَا يُقَدِّمُ شَيْئًا وَلَا يُؤَخَّرُ إِنَّمَا يُسْتَخْرَجُ بِالنَّذْرِ مِنَ الْبَخِيلِ. He said, a vow neither hastens nor delays anything. يعني he doesn't hasten the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not write for you to get married with so-and-so, you will not get married with her. That's it. Just forget about it. You'll get married with someone else. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not write that He did not decree for you that you get married with so-and-so. Right? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying it's a pointless. Don't make it. إِنَّمَا يُسْتَخْرَجُ بِالنَّذْرِ مِنَ الْبَخِيلِ. He said, but by making this vow, some of the wealth of the miser will be taken out. The miser. Why is a miser? Because, ya Allah, if you do this for me, I'll pay this. If you don't do it, I'm not going to pay. So that's why Rasulullah ﷺ, he said, إِنَّمَا يُسْتَخْرَجُ بِهِ مِنَا الْبَخِيلِ. And this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. Now, how about vows regarding things which are not legislated in Sharia? Yani things that are crazy things, but they're not legislated as an act of ibadah or an act of obedience. We have a good example that took place at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said the hadith in this hadith in Sunan Abi Dawud, while the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was delivering a khutbah, sermon, then he saw a man standing, and everyone was sitting down listening to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this guy is standing outside. There was an opening or a gate, so Rasulullah was able to see him standing outside under the sun, the heat of the sun. So, and then he asked about him, and they told him he is Abu Israel. His name was Abu Israel. He vowed that he will stand and never sit down. I don't know what is the explanation of this. Allahu alam. He vowed to stand and never sit down. He will never come in the shade, nor speak to anybody. He vowed not to speak to anyone. Just keep quiet for his... I don't know what is the reason of this vow. And to fast. The last one makes sense. It's an act of ibadah. And to fast. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala li rajulin. He was talking to a man. He said, murhu. فَلْيَتَكَلَّمْ وَلْيَسْتَظِلْ وَلْيَقْعُدْ وَلْيُتِمَّ صَوْمَهُمْ. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, tell him to speak. He doesn't need to make this weird, this crazy vow. Tell him to speak. Let him come into in the shade. And make him sit down. وَلْيُتِمَّ صَوْمَهُ. And let him complete his fast. So this is the only thing that makes sense, which is fasting. It's an ibadah. But the other things don't make sense at all. Standing up and not sitting down or not speaking to other people, there is no reason for that. So you are not supposed to fulfill this kind of vows. طيب, the ulama have mentioned around 7 types of vows. I'll mention them very quickly now, and then I'll give you a chance to ask some questions if you want before al-Maghrib. The first type of nadhr is called nadhr al-lijaj. Al-lajaj wal-ghadab. When someone is angry, it's called a vow of anger. When someone is angry and he wants to stop someone else from doing something, or he wants to encourage himself to do it, and he's excited and angry, and he said, I will do this and this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he really doesn't mean to make any vow to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he is angry or he's excited, or he wants to stop his brother or his mother or his wife from doing something. He's making this statement. So the ulama, they said, this is not a nadhr, and it takes the ruling of a yameen, or of an oath, and he doesn't have to fulfill his vow, but he has to pay the kafara. And the kafara of a nadhr is the same kafara of an oath, the same. You know, the feeding 10 people, clothing them, freeing slave, or if you are not cannot afford these three things, you move to the next step, which is fasting 3 days. So this is the ruling of this nadr, this crazy nadr. The second one, nadr al-ta'a, the vow of obedience. You say, I vow to fast 3 days for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this month, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cures my brother or my mother. Or I have to pay sadaqah, then you have to fulfill this vow. You have to fulfill this vow. You fast those 3 days or you pay this sadaqah. لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من نذر أن يطيع الله فليطيعه. Whoever vows to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he should remain obedient to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is number two, nadhr al-ta'a, the vow of obedience. The third one, al-nadhr al-mubham. Al-mubham, ambiguous, the ambiguous vow. Yani he doesn't mention anything. He say, I will do something for the sake of Allah. What are you gonna do? We don't know. So هذا نذر مبهم. And there are people who make this kind of statement. Some ulama, they said you need to make a kafara, the kafara of yameen, kafara al yameen. So kafara to nadhr إذا لم يسمى كفارة يمين. This is a hadith Hassan. They said the kafara, the expiation of another when it is not named. It is not named. This is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. يعني the person does not mention anything. He doesn't mention sadaqah or fasting or dhabiha or anything. Then it is the same expiation. It will be like the expiation of an oath. Wallahu ta'ala alam. Nadhr al-ma'asiyah. Al-ma'asiyah. Someone who vows to drink alcohol, or to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to hurt another Muslim, or to cut the ties of kinship with his family members. Anything that is a ma'asiyah. Here the ulama, they said, لا يحل الوفاء به. It is not permissible to fulfill this kind of vows, because it is an act of disobedience. You cannot vow to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many ulama, they said he has to pay the same expiation, كفارة اليمين, والله تعالى أعلم. Number five, النذر المباح. يعني, I will ride this camel, I will dress this, wear this clothes, this garment, I will go to visit this town if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me this. This is permissible. These are not acts of obedience. These are mubahat, permissible things, or things that are permissible to do. And he should, النذر المباح قالوا يخير فيه النذر بين الوفاء والترك مع الكفارة. You have the choice not to fulfill the vow, because it's not an act of obedience. And you can break this vow and pay the kafara, wallahu ta'ala alam. And nadhr al-wajib, they said, is the vow to perform some obligatory acts of ibadah, some obligations. Yeah, مثلاً, I vow to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to pray 5 daily prayers. You don't need to make a vow for this, because it is an obligation upon you to pray the 5 daily prayers. Or I vow to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I vow that I will fast in the month of Ramadan for the sake of Allah. So you don't need to make this vow, because it is an obligation upon you to fast the month of Ramadan. So they said he has to pray and he has to fast. And لا يجب به شيء لا يجب شيئا. يعني there is no expiation if he breaks. It's a ma'asiyah. If he doesn't pray the 5 daily prayers, it's a ma'asiyah. He has to pray. He has to take care of his prayers. They said there is no expiation here. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. These are the 7 types of vows. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Jazakumullahu khairan. We have 10 minutes before we pray Maghrib. Maghrib is 8:30 today, right? So we have 10 minutes before the Iqama. If you have some questions. Yes, brother. The time limit. So some ulama, they said تجب على الفور. تجب على الفور, يعني whenever it's possible for you to pay it, you should pay it. You shouldn't delay it on purpose.
You have to do each 3 of those things or just one of them?
No, I said أنت مخير. You have the choice to do the first one or the second one or the third one. If you can't afford any of these 3, then you move to the other step, which is fasting 3 days. So you have the choice, أنت مخير. You do only one thing. That would be very difficult to do all three. Salaamu alaykum. Jazakallah khair, Shaykh. May Allah increase your knowledge. Jazakallah khair. Does the kafara have to be paid specifically to just Muslims, or can you give the kafara to non-Muslims? Fidya is paid specifically to Muslims. Wallah, this is a good question, and I believe that you can give it to Muslims and non-Muslims, but this is something that I need to confirm. Because when it comes to freeing a slave, many scholars, they said you can free a non-Muslim slave. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say raqaba mu'mina, He did not say a mu'min, a believing slave. In some other ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that he has to be a mu'min. So what I believe is that it is permissible to give it to a non-Muslim, but I just have to confirm it. Because it's like a sadaqah, wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Zakat, we usually give it to Muslims if they are fuqara and needy. In some cases, we are allowed to give it to some non-Muslims, in some cases, zakat. But anyway, this is what I believe, but this is something that I need to confirm. Yes?
I have two questions, Sheikh. My first question is, can you fast 3 consecutive days, even if you don't know if it's broken an oath, as like an insurance policy?
Can you what?
Can you fast or feed 10 masakin as an insurance policy? Let's say you did something and you don't know about it. Can it be like an insurance policy to...
Yeah, you just feed in case you break one of your oaths and you are not sure about it.
Yes.
Yeah, you can do that to be in the safe side.
Yes.
And you thought maybe you made an oath and you didn't fulfill it, so it's better to feed 10 days, not fasting. If you are thinking about an oath, then you should give sadaqah to 10 people, feed 10 people. As I said, you don't move to fasting. You don't go to the option of fasting unless you are not able to afford to do the other things.
And my second question was, when family members make an oath that you do something or you're not allowed to do something, in that case, what should you do?
If you do it? If you do it, yes. If your father tells you, makes an oath, asking you not to do something, and then you do it, then he has to fulfill, he has to pay the expiation.
Is there sin upon you for not
fulfilling the wish of your father? It depends. If your father asks you to do something that is muharram, then you have to disobey him, because it is a ma'siyah. You cannot obey your father and disobey Allah. But if it is an act of obedience or something good for you, for the family, you should fulfill his wish because he's your father. The obedience, ta'atul walidain. Ta'atul walidain. Obedience of your parents. Kind is part of our kind treatment of our parents. Birrul walidain. You know, when it is permissible, when it is halal, it's good for you, good for your family, or it is an act of ibadah, then you should do it. Yeah, go ahead.
For breaking 2 or 3 oaths, and then is kafara needed for each oath or one kafara?
Yeah, for breaking multiple oaths. Okay, if the oath is about the same thing, so by Allah, I will not eat this food. By Allah, I will not eat this food. By Allah, I will not eat this food. About the same food, huh? So it's enough to, if you break your oath and you ate this food, then it is enough to pay only one kafara. Even though the oath was repeated 3 times, but it is about one thing. But if the oath is about multiple things, so by Allah I will not eat this food, by Allah I will not spend the night tonight in my house, and by the night I will not travel tomorrow to Erdri or to Chestermere. And then you break all these oaths. you eat from this food, you change your mind and you went to your house, and tomorrow you went to Chestermere. Here you have to pay 3 kafaras. So you have to feed 30 people. 30 people. Because three multiple things. You see the difference? When the oath is about one thing and it is repeated, it's okay. It's only one oath, one kafara. If it is about multiple things, then it is every oath. For every oath, you have to pay a kafara, or for one kafara, which is, as I said, feeding 10 people.
It is the same as he's in anger or she's in anger when making oath. It's the same kafara.
Yeah, if he has the intention to make an oath, this is the criteria. How we distinguish between yameen al-lagh, mistaken oath, and the enacted oath, al-mun'aqidah. If you have the intention to make the oath, then it is mun'aqidah, you have to pay the kafara. If it is a mistaken oath, you just said it because it is your habit to mention the name of Allah, then there is nothing upon you. You got it now? And you know yourself, you know your intention. Yes? Mafish kafara. There is no kafara for yameen al-ghamus. It is a major sin. Al-ghamus, the engulfing oath, when the person is lying on purpose while using the name of Allah, is a major sin and there is no kafara for it. The only kafara is to make tawbah and istighfar. And if someone took something from another Muslim through this yameen, through this oath, then he has to give it back to his brother. This is his tawbah and he has to make istighfar. And he has to have a firm intention not to do it again in the future. بين الزوج والزوجة يعني يكذب على زوجته يعني lying to his wife. Yeah, there is, in Sharia there is an exception without using the name of Allah. There is an exception if you if you are trying to fix your relationship, improve your relationship with your wife, you are allowed to use, to lie, to give some false information, but don't use the name of Allah. Huh? You got my message now? Just to be in the safe side, don't use the name of Allah. If she tells you then, ihlif, then it's a different story. You are in trouble. Yes. نعم if you break the vow يعني you make a vow to obey Allah to fast مثلا 3 days and you didn't fast there is a kafara yeah and the same kafara like the kafara of اليمين yeah for all vows but we said there are different types of vows. The same kafara. Same, you follow the same steps. Yeah.
Let's say you make an oath to exit sin. Say like your parents say like you want to stop smoking.
And then you smoke again.
You smoke again, pay the kafara. Is the oath invalidated or does the oath carry on? Then you keep paying kafara on that.
Could you say it again? Yeah. Yeah.
Is the oath invalid, or does the oath continue to carry, and you're required?
If you break your oath one time and you pay the kafara, then you are not bound to observe this oath because it was a broken. Anyway, it was a broken. You paid the kafara, then you are relieved from the first oath. But don't make another oath. If someone has a problem, a smoking problem, and he wants to stop smoking, instead of making vows or oaths, you just have to have a firm intention not to do it. Think about, يعني, مثلاً, you should think about the health, you know, consequences or consequences upon your pocket, مثلاً, losing money or the bad smell. Or, this is just an example. The brother is mentioning an example. This is an example. But sometimes, yes, people make oaths about other different things. You know, about not watching some movies or not doing few things. If they break the oath, yeah, they have to pay the kafara. Because it is yameen mun'aqidah. There is no doubt about it. Yes?
So if you don't take the oath, but you have a strong intention, let's say you say, inshallah, Inshallah, I will do Hajj in next 3 years.
Inshallah, I will?
I'll do Hajj in next 3 years.
I will do what?
Hajj.
Hajj. Yeah. This is not nadr, and this is, even if it is nadr, there is no kafara for it, because this is an obligation. So if you, this is not nadr and this is not an oath, just a promise. You're promising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that inshallah you will do Hajj. And by the way, when you say inshallah, your oath, even if you break your oath, you will not be guilty of breaking the oath, of perjury. They call it perjury in English. The guilt of breaking your oath. If you say inshallah, because you don't know if you'll be able to make Hajj within 3 years or not. Right? So this is just a promise. So the ulama, they said a promise, a regular promise, is not an oath and is not a vow. So you see the difference now? Yeah, there is another question from sisters here. The second, or freeing a slave, instead of slaying a human being, can we free a bird or another animal? This is not something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, so it shouldn't be an option. It shouldn't be an option because it's not something. Actually, there is a hikmah behind freeing slaves, because the Sharia meant to free slaves, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it as a kafara, expiation for many sins. So many people will earn their freedom through this, because it was a system that was established at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Islam meant to, you know, that people will earn their freedom through different ways, but this is one of them. Yes. The last question, because we're going to make iqama now, or adhan and iqama. Last question. No, we cannot keep people waiting. Yes?
You mentioned small share or minor share. What about like people that celebrate holidays, occasions,
that they're turning
it into?
What kind of holiday?
Birthdays.
Birthday is not an act of shirk. It's not legislated in Sharia, it's not sunnah. But it's not an act of shirk.
Even if it becomes a regular festival that
you're... Birthday parties?
Yeah.
No. The ulama, they said we are not supposed to do them because they are not part of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah did not celebrate birthday, but definitely they are not an act of shirk. Or celebrating the milad of a nabi, it is bid'ah, but it's not an act of shirk. Someone will say, I'm going to Milad al-Nabi to eat some food and talk about Prophet Muhammad. This is not an act of shirk, but this is bid'ah. What is bid'ah? It's an innovation. Something that is innovated in the deen. Rasulullah did not do it. The Sahaba did not do it. We should not do it. If someone knows about it, this is a bid'ah, and he does it on purpose, it could be a sin. It is a sin. But it's not an act of shirk. So we have to be careful about what is shirk and what is not. جزاكم الله خيرا.